we continue our coverage of Saudi Arabia and its U.S.-supported war on Yemen. This week, Secretary of Defense James Mattis called for a ceasefire to be reached in the country within the next 30 days.
Now, war, I will just tell you, I've got little experience in it, is basically one tragedy piled upon another tragedy. You know, welcome to war. But our goal right now is to achieve a level of capability by those forces fighting against the Houthis that they are not killing innocent people. Longer term solution, and by longer term, I mean 30 days from now, we want to see everybody around a peace table based on a ceasefire, based on a pullback from the border, and then based on ceasing dropping of bombs.
Mattis's demand for a peace table comes 3 years and 7 months into the war on Yemen, which has already left up to 80,000 people dead, according to recent estimates. On top of the war, the Saudi-imposed economic blockade of the country has pushed 14 million Yemenis to the brink of famine, with an estimated 50,000 children believed to have starved to death last year alone. What's more, a cholera outbreak in the country is thought to infect an additional 10,000 people per week. Here is how one member of the Houthi Political Council in Yemen reacted to Mattis's comments.
Stopping the war and the acts of aggression, first of all, from the aggressor states, which are supported by the U.S., the country of this Secretary of State, is of a necessity. We currently are not acting as aggressors against any of our neighbor states. They are doing so against us. And so when the war stops and the aggression against us stops, we will be for a peace which will preserve our independence and protect our independent entity from any interference from any other state, whether they are neighboring or not.
With U.S. support for Saudi Arabia's war on Yemen in question, the team here thought now would be a good time to examine the root of Washington and Riyadh's special relationship. Producer Kei Pritsker is here to discuss exactly that history. You were so popular earlier in the week, Kei, that we just had to bring you back. This relationship kicks off in 1931. That's when the United States formally recognized Saudi Arabia and established diplomatic relations. What was behind that decision?
Yeah, so in 1931, the Saudi ruling class was looking for international recognition, and they struck a deal with the United States. John D. Rockefeller Standard Oil was given the right to explore Dahran's oil fields in exchange for the creation of U.S.-Saudi diplomatic ties. Fast forward to 1943, the relationship expands when Italy bombs Saudi Arabia, and Saudi kind of realizes they don't have a military to defend itself, and then FDR says the defense of Saudi Arabia is vital to the defense of the United States. It's an interesting statement, but if you take the U.S.'s interest in Saudi's oil into account, it makes a lot of sense. And then in 1951, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers creates its first military installment in Saudi Arabia.
And then we fast forward a few decades to 1971, which saw the collapse of the international gold standard. Why was this development crucial to the U.S.-Saudi relationship?
So in 1944, the Bretton Woods system was established, and this was the international gold standard being turned into an international dollar gold standard. So the international community decided it was easier to transact in U.S. dollars, so they equated dollars to gold by pricing an ounce of gold at $35 per ounce. And this peg was up to the U.S. to maintain, and it was done on the honor system. The U.S. violated this exchange rate by printing more dollars than they had in gold. They were essentially printing receipts for gold that they didn't have. And the international community caught on to this. And when they tried to get their gold back, the U.S. President Nixon, on August 15, 1971, suspended the convertibility of gold into dollars. So what happened is, you know, before 1971, all the countries in the world needed dollars on hand because that represented their gold reserves. After 1971, they were just holding on to paper. So the U.S., you know, these countries didn't need the U.S. dollar anymore. So the U.S. was looking for a way to make the international community dependent on the dollar again. And they found that reason in 1973 when this oil crisis began. So in 1973, the Yom Kippur War starts. And the United States supports Israel, as it usually does, and Saudi Arabia, being an Arab country, supports the Palestinians. And in order to retaliate against the U.S., they create this oil embargo. They do that by decreasing their oil production, which raises the price of oil for Americans.
Right.
And there are these long oil lines, there are oil rations, gas stations shut down. And you know, Henry Kissinger goes to Saudi Arabia in 1974 to strike a deal to end the oil embargo. And this deal is struck, the terms of that deal first being, so the first being that Saudi Aramco, which was back then Aramco, was gradually to be turned over to Saudi Arabia. This was a decade-long process. And then the U.S. also pledged further military support and arms sales to Saudi Arabia.
I think we have a list of some more aspects of this deal, right? This is what you're talking about?
Yes. So if you ever wonder why the U.S. has been arming Saudi to the teeth, it comes from this deal. You know, the original military support was a few million dollars, then it graduated to hundreds of millions of dollars, then to a few billion dollars. Now, you know, Trump is funding the Saudis at, they're arming them at the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars. And then on the Saudi side of the deal, Saudi agrees to only sell oil in U.S. dollars and gets OPEC to do the same thing. This is the birth of the petrodollar. So the petrodollar is basically a system where all countries in the world need a constant supply of dollars on hand to buy oil. It's the only currency that will buy oil, and it's that way to this day. And that, you know, as we spoke about earlier, that once again creates a situation where every single country in the world needs U.S. dollars on hand. Mm. It really strengthens the U.S. dollar. And then, you know, Saudi also lowered their oil prices, ending the crisis.
So Saudi Arabia essentially saved the U.S. dollar by saying, look, we'll only accept this currency for purchasing oil. Mm-hmm. How does all of this lead to today, the situation we're seeing in Yemen, and sort of the modern relationship we see with Saudi Arabia?
Yeah, so obviously there's a lot of money and power involved in this relationship, and it only strengthened after the 1974 deal. And the U.S. and Saudi had to kind of put aside some of their differences, and they realized a lot of their interests actually aligned. So with Israel, for example, you know, after the Yom Kippur War, the U.S. said, your problem isn't Israel. They're not really a threat to you. The real threat is communism. And, you know, today you see MBS being very, you know, pro-Israel. They he recently told the Palestinian Authority, you're asking for too much in this peace deal. Shut up and, you know, take the deal you're given. Same thing with Wahhabism. In this case, the United States had to cozy up to Saudi. Wahhabism is the radical ideology held by many of the Saudi ruling class. It's a literal interpretation of Islam that most Muslims don't adhere to, but it sees the world through this, you know, Sunni-Shia conflict, and it often blames Iran, the major Shia power in the region, you know, as being behind a lot of these spats in, say, Syria or Yemen, as we talked about. Saudi sees them as proxy wars, sites of proxy wars between those two powers. And, you know, the U.S. and Saudi Arabia both have a vested interest in opposing Iran. But when it comes to communism, Saudi Arabia wasn't really against communism up until this deal was signed. The U.S. has been fighting communism during the Cold War, and they were opposing it in Afghanistan, and Saudi really picked up the slack there by funding the Mujahideen alongside the United States, which later became Al-Qaeda.
Became Al-Qaeda. We all know how that story goes. Briefly on the oil price manipulation.
Yeah, so the U.S. will often tap Saudi Arabia, which is the largest oil exporter in OPEC. They control 25% of OPEC's oil exports. They'll tap them and say, you know, hey, can you raise your oil production, which lowers the oil price. That hurts countries that rely on oil export revenue like Russia, Iran, Venezuela, countries that, you know, the United States and Saudi both dislike. And, you know, this goes as deep as, you know, in 2002, Saddam Hussein tried to sell oil in euros, and the U.S., that was a threat to the petrodollar system, and the U.S. invaded Iraq over that. In 2011, Muammar Gaddafi tried to create a gold-backed dinar currency for the African continent, and NATO promptly killed him. So this is a very lucrative business, and it all goes back to this petrodollar system. That relationship needs to be maintained in order for both U.S. and Saudi to profit.
And it's a very dangerous game. As we mentioned, though, some of these countries, Iran, Venezuela, Russia, are looking to move away from the dollar system.
Yes.
And change all of this. So we'll see what happens. Producer Kei Pritsker, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Hey YouTube, thanks for checking out our channel. We hope you enjoyed the video. We have tons of content for you just like this. For more of RT America's one-of-a-kind news and analysis, be sure to subscribe to never stop questioning more.